This picture shows the heart. The heart is a conical muscular organ whose muscle tissue is striated, has striated muscle fibers, but its function is involuntary, and thus the muscle of the heart is supplied by autonomic nerve fibers, sympathetic and parasympathetic. As regards the shape of the heart, which is conical, it has a base marked number A and an apex marked number B. The base is directed upward and backward, where it comes in contact with the thoracic vertebrae from number 5 to number 8, but its apex is directed downward, forward, and to the left. And this apex, because it is directed forward, it comes in contact with the chest wall, and thus the apex beat can be palpated or felt on the chest wall. This is the direction of the apex. The base is formed by the right and the left atria, but the apex is formed by the left ventricle only. Number C shows the axis of the heart. The axis of the heart is directed downward, forward, and to the left. But in some congenital anomalies, the axis is directed not to the left but to the right due to abnormal development. And in such a case, the abnormal position or shape, the heart is described to be a case of dextrocardia. Dextro means to the right, which means that the heart is directed to the right. Dextrocardia, this is an abnormal congenital anomaly. This diagram shows the position of the anterior surface of the heart in relation to the chest wall. The anterior surface of the heart is also called sternocostal surface because it lies in relation to the sternum and the ribs, especially the ribs of the left side. As regards the position of this surface, the right third of this surface lies to the right of the midline of the body, which is marked by number C, while the left two-thirds of this surface lies to the left of this midline. And these relations are of importance in cases of disease of the heart, as for example, enlargement of one side of the heart more than the other, or displacement of the heart to one side or the other. Number A is the base of the heart. Number B is the apex of the heart. Number C is the midline. This picture shows the features of the sternocostal surface of the heart, or the anterior surface of the heart, which comes in relation to the sternum and the ribs. Let us begin by the right side of this diagram or picture. Number three is the auricle of the right atrium, and this auricle in anatomy means a prolongation, a prolongation of the right atrium. It is a fleshy prolongation of the right atrium, and thus this right auricle covers the right atrium. Number two is ascending aorta, and this ascending aorta arises from the left ventricle. Number one is the superior vena cava as it descends to open into the right atrium. Number 12 is the arch of the aorta, giving its three main branches. Number 11 is the pulmonary trunk. Note its position to the ascending aorta. The ascending aorta is number 2. At its origin, below the pulmonary trunk lies in front of the origin of the ascending aorta. But as the pulmonary trunk comes upward, it lies on the left side of the ascending aorta, where it divides into two divisions, right and left pulmonary arteries. So the pulmonary artery is at first in front of the ascending aorta below, but on its left side above. Number 10 is the auricle of the left atrium. Also, it is a prolongation from the left atrium and covers the atrium. Number 7 is the apex of the heart, and it is formed by the left ventricle, which is marked number 8. Number 8 is the left ventricle, and it ends below as the apex of the heart, which is number 7. Number 6 is the right ventricle. The right ventricle. And number 5 is the lower border of the heart. Note the difference in extent or in surface area between the right ventricle, which is number 6, and the left ventricle, which is number 8, on the anterior surface of the heart, on the sternocostal surface of the heart. The right ventricle is much larger than the surface of the left ventricle, but this relation is reversed on the back of the heart, where the left ventricle forms much of the posterior surface of the heart, and the right ventricle forms a lesser space, lesser area. So here the right ventricle appears forming most of the surface, most of the surface of the ventricles. And as we go up from the surface of the right ventricle, which is number 6, we find that it leads to the pulmonary trunk, which is number 11. It leads to the pulmonary trunk, which is number 11. In addition to this general description, there are two arteries which we can see on the anterior or sternocostal surface. Number four is the right coronary artery. The right coronary artery. And it lies in a groove between the right atrium and right ventricle, called atrioventricular groove. Number four is the right coronary artery passing in the atrioventricular groove on the anterior surface. This groove between the right atrium and the right ventricle. Another artery is also present on the anterior surface of the heart, is number 9. This artery is a branch from the left coronary. Branch, not the left coronary itself, but it is a branch. And this branch is called anterior interventricular branch. Anterior interventricular branch. Why it's called like this? Because it lies between the right ventricle on the right side of it and the left ventricle on its left side. And this branch, which is the anterior interventricular branch, lie in the anterior interventricular groove, anterior interventricular groove between the right ventricle and left ventricle. These are just a general description of the features of the sternocostal surface. This figure shows the course of the atrioventricular groove or sulcus. This groove, which lies between the two atria on one side and the two ventricles on the other side. And this groove or sulcus lodges the right and the left coronary arteries and the accompanying veins. This sulcus encircles the heart transversely around it, and it begins at the sides of the root of the pulmonary trunk. At the sides of the root of the pulmonary trunk. So let us see number one. Number one is the right part of the atrioventricular sulcus, the anterior part, because it lies on the anterior surface or the sternocostal surface. Number one, between the right atrium on the right side and the right ventricle on the left side. And we can follow its beginning on the right side of the pulmonary trunk. On the opposite side of the pulmonary trunk is the left part of the sulcus. And this left part of the sulcus is encircling or winding or curving around the left border of the heart. The same as the right part, which is number one, which also curves around the right border of the heart to reach the back. So the right part of the sulcus and the left part of the sulcus meet together on the back or the posterior surface of the heart, and thus they are forming a circle. But this circle is incomplete anteriorly where the root of the pulmonary trunk lies. Number four marks the posterior part of the atrioventricular sulcus. Number five is the ventricular part. Number three is the left auricle. Number two is the right auricle. This picture shows the course of the interventricular grooves, which are the grooves which lie between the right and the left ventricles on the anterior and posterior surfaces of the heart. And by the way, the posterior surface of the heart is also called the inferior surface of the heart, because it is directed inferiorly where it lies on the upper surface of the diaphragm. But anyway, the two terms are of the same meaning. These interventricular grooves, one is on the anterior surface, as I mentioned, and it lodges the anterior interventricular artery and the accompanying vein. and the artery is a branch from the left coronary artery. This is number 4. Number 4 is the anterior interventricular groove, while number 2 is the inferior or posterior interventricular groove, and it lodges the inferior or posterior interventricular artery and the accompanying vein, and the artery is a branch from the right coronary artery on the back of the heart. And these anterior and posterior interventricular arteries meet and join each other near the apex of the heart, a very short distance to the right of the apex, not at the apex itself, but a short distance to the right of the apex. Number 3 is the left ventricle. Number 1 is the right ventricle. So these interventricular grooves form a U-shaped arrangement. A U-shaped arrangement on the ventricles, on the anterior and the posterior surfaces of the heart, curving and meeting and joining each other at the inferior border of the heart to the right of the apex. This picture shows the parts of the anterior surface or sternocostal surface of the heart, and by parts is meant the atrial part and the ventricular part, which are separated from each other by the atrioventricular sulcus or atrioventricular groove, and sometimes also this groove or sulcus is called the coronary sulcus or coronary groove because of the presence of the right and left coronary arteries in this sulcus. Here, the atrial part of this surface forms the upper part and is formed of the right and the left atria. And the right atrium and its covering auricle, which is number 2, is well shown and visible on the anterior surface, while only part of the left atrium covered by the left auricle, number 6, is shown on the anterior surface, because the rest of the left atrium is hidden behind the roots of the pulmonary trunk, number 1, and the ascending aorta on its right side. The left atrium is hidden, lies behind the roots of these two vessels. And what appears on the anterior surface of the heart is only the auricle, number 6, and a small part of the left atrium deeper to the auricle. But the right atrium and right auricle are completely exposed on the anterior surface. This is the atrial part, which forms the base of the heart. And by the way, the root of the pulmonary trunk and the ascending aorta are only seen and present on the anterior surface, and they are taken as a guide to the student to identify the anterior surface of the heart. these big vessels are a guide to identify that this surface is the anterior surface or the sternocostal surface. Now let us move to the ventricular part of the anterior surface, the ventricular part, which is the lower part, and it is larger than the atrial part and is divided by the interventricular groove number 5 into a part belonging to the right ventricle number 3 and a part belonging to the left ventricle number 4. So number 5 is a vertical groove, longitudinal groove between the right ventricle and the left ventricle, and it is called the anterior interventricular groove because it lies on the anterior surface. And we should note that the part belonging to the right ventricle forms the right two-thirds of the ventricular part, while the part belonging to the left ventricle, number 4, forms only the left third. So the majority of the surface here of the ventricles is belonging to the right ventricle. The left ventricle ends below at the apex of the heart. The left ventricle, number 4, ends below at the apex of the heart, the tip of the ventricle. And this apex of the heart lies at the level of the fifth intercostal space, 3.5 inches or 9 centimeters from the midline, of the sternum. And also, it lies just medial to the midclavicular line, to the midclavicular line, or simply in the midclavicular line, simply. But we should remember its distance from the midline, 9 centimeters, and should remember the fifth intercostal space. Why to remember this? Because the apex of the heart is usually used clinically to feel the apex beat of the heart. And if the heart is in its normal size, the apex will be in its normal position. But if the, for example, the left ventricle is enlarged, the apex will move laterally away from its normal position. Or if the heart is displaced, also the apex will move from the normal position. And if the heart is in its congenital anomaly called dextrocardia, where the heart is with its apex are directed to the right side, you will not feel the apex in the left side in its normal position, but it will be left on the right side. So remembering the site of the apex of the heart is of clinical importance. It lies in the fifth intercostal space, 9 centimeters from the midline, or very simply opposite the left midclavicular line, or just close to it, just close. Number 6 is the left auricle. Number 1 is the root of the pulmonary trunk. Number 2 is the right atrium with its auricle. And note, by the way, that this right atrium forms the whole right border of the heart, the whole right border of the heart. Number 3 is the right ventricle. And note that the inferior or lower border of the heart is formed by the two ventricles, the right ventricle right two thirds. The left ventricle, the left third. While the left border of the heart is formed mainly by the left ventricle and by a small part above by the left auricle, which is number 6. This is the back of the heart, or the posterior aspect of the heart, to show the atrial part above and the ventricular part below, and they are separated from each other by the posterior part of the atrioventricular sulcus or atrioventricular groove, which is number 3. The atrial part is formed mainly by the left atrium, and number 1 marks the back of the left atrium. And this back of the left atrium is bounded on the left side by the two pulmonary veins coming from the left lung, number 2. Number 2 are the left two pulmonary veins, and on the opposite margin of the back of the left atrium, the left atrium is number 1, there are the two right pulmonary veins coming from the right lung, and close to these right pulmonary veins lie the superior vena cava above and entering the right atrium, and the inferior vena cava below, which is marked number 8, and entering the right atrium from below. Note that the part of the right atrium here, which is to the right side of the two right pulmonary veins, is smaller in relation to the left atrium number 1, because as I mentioned before, the left atrium mainly lies on the back of the heart, and here number 1 is the back of the left atrium. Below the atrioventricular sulcus or groove, which is a posterior part on the back of the heart, below this sulcus lies the ventricular part of the heart. Lies the right and the left ventricles of the heart. The right ventricle, number 4. And the left ventricle is number 4. The left ventricle is number 4, and it forms the apex of the heart, number 5, while the right ventricle is marked by number 7, and these two ventricles are separated from each other by a longitudinal groove, which is number 6, which is the inferior or posterior interventricular groove. Compare here on the inferior, on the posterior aspect of the heart, compare the area of the left ventricle, which is number 4, compare it with the area of the right ventricle, which is number 7. You find that the left ventricle formed the left two-thirds of this surface, while the right ventricle forms the right third only, the reverse of the case or the condition on the anterior surface, where the right ventricle forms the right two-thirds and the left ventricle forms the left third. number 5 is the apex of the heart and is formed by the left ventricle. Number 4, these are the features of the back or posterior aspect of the heart. This picture shows the four orifices of the right and the left ventricles. These orifices, which lie at the base of the heart, where the pulmonary trunk and ascending aorta arise from the ventricles. The pulmonary trunk arises from the right ventricle and the ascending aorta arises from the left ventricle. These vessels are present at their origin or at their orifices, at their orifices in the ventricles. They lie one in front of the other. In the figure here, number one is the orifice of the pulmonary trunk, and number two is the orifice of the ascending aorta. The pulmonary trunk is in front of the ascending aorta. These are the orifices of the beginning of these vessels, and here they are provided with valves. The pulmonary valve in number one and the aortic valve in number two. Posterior to these two vessels, there are two orifices, but one on the side of the other. Number five is the right atrioventricular orifice. Is the orifice between the right atrium and the right ventricle. So it is called right atrioventricular orifice and is provided by a valve with three cusps, and sometimes it's called a tricuspid valve, tricuspid, having three cusps. This is number five, the right atrioventricular. But on its left side, there is a left atrioventricular orifice, which is number three, that lies between the left atrium and the left ventricle. But this orifice is provided only by two cusps, and therefore the valve is called bicuspid, or another name which is more common is called the mitral valve. The mitral valve is bicuspid, has only two cusps, and it guards the left atrioventricular orifice. The left atrioventricular orifice lies to the left of the right atrioventricular orifice, and these two orifices lie behind the aortic orifice and the pulmonary orifice. Note that these four orifices are on the same level, on the same plane, at the base of the heart, between the atria and the ventricles, on the same level, the same horizontal line. And here the four orifices are surrounded by strong fibrous tissue called the fibrous skeleton of the heart. The fibrous skeleton of the heart marked by number 4, this fibrous skeleton supports the orifices in place and prevent their collapse during contraction of the muscle of the heart. And in addition, this fibrous skeleton gives insertion to the muscular loops of the muscle tissue of the ventricles. This is the fibrous skeleton which surrounds these orifices and lie in between them. It lies at the plane between the atria above and the ventricles below. Number P is a posterior aspect. Number R, or letter R, is the right aspect. Number A is the anterior aspect. The letter L is the left aspect to show the directions, to show the directions and the relations of these orifices. This picture shows a posteroanterior radiograph of the chest, posteroanterior radiograph or X-ray picture, and by posteroanterior means that the X-rays pass through the chest from behind forward. That's why it's called posteroanterior. And radiograph means X-ray picture, and the process is called radiography. This picture shows mainly the heart and the related structures. Let us begin from above. Number 6. Number 6 is the shadow of the trachea. A trachea. And this shadow of the trachea lies exactly in the midline, equidistant between the medial ends of the right and left clavicles, right and left sternoclavicular joints. This is a normal position of the tracheal shadow. But if it is shifted more to the right side or more to the left side, this means that there is something wrong inside the chest which led to this shift. And you have to know that the trachea is easily movable. It moves easily from side to side. But the normal position, and you have to check it in the X-ray picture, is that it lies equidistant between the two sternoclavicular joints, the right and the left. This is number 6. On the right side of the picture of the heart, we see number 1. Number 1 on the right border of the picture. It marks the right brachiocephalic vein. Number 2 marks the superior vena cava. In the right border of the shadow of the heart. Number 3 is called hilar shadow. Hilar from the hilum of the lung. And the shadow is the shadow of the blood vessels, the pulmonary blood vessels that enter through the hilum and radiate inside the lung. And therefore, it gives such a shadow, one on the right side and one on the left side. Number 2 is the hilar shadow on the right side. Then we continue below. Number 4 is a slight bulge of the right atrium which forms the right border of the heart below. Number four is the right atrium. Number five is a recess or an angle formed between the heart and the dome of the diaphragm. And this angle is called cardiophrenic angle. Number five, cardiophrenic, between the heart and the diaphragm. Number 13 is the right dome of the liver, right convexity, and it is higher, slightly higher than the left one because of the liver. A large size of the right lobe of the liver pushes the diaphragm on the right side higher than, more than the left side, and this is the right dome of the liver. Number 13. Number 14 is also an angle or recess between the diaphragm and the ribs, and this is the costo-diaphragmatic recess of the pleura. Costo-diaphragmatic recess of the pleura, number 14. All these features can be examined by the X-ray, the posterior-anterior X-ray. Number 12, here is the right ventricle, and number 11 is the apex of the heart, which is formed by the left ventricle. Number 10 is the left ventricle, and as we go up, number 9, here is the left auricle, the auricle of the left atrium, as it overlaps the pulmonary trunk. So number 9 marks both of them, the pulmonary trunk and the covering auricle of the left atrium. Number 8 is a bulge formed by the lateral convexity of the aortic arch, forming a bulge directed to the left, and it's called aortic knuckle. Number 7 marks the branches of the aortic arch that runs up, and these are the left common carotid and the left subclavian arteries. These are the main features of the posterior-anterior radiograph. This X-ray picture is an oblique lateral radiograph. Oblique lateral radiograph, which means that the X-rays pass from the back of the chest forward and laterally, obliquely. Forward and lateral. Therefore, it is called an oblique lateral radiograph. And this obliquity of the X-rays may be to oblique to the right side or to the left side. Here is a picture, simple picture, about an oblique lateral radiograph, to show the following features. The main feature here is number 2. This is a cardiac shadow, the shadow of the heart. Large area behind the body of the sternum and in front of the thoracic vertebrae. The space between this cardiac shadow, which is number 2, and the sternum, this space, which is marked number 1, represents the anterior mediastina. The anterior mediastina is the space between the heart shadow and the sternum. While the space behind the cardiac shed, which is number 4, and represents the posterior mediastinum, it's called the retro, means behind, retrocardiac shed. So number 4 is the retrocardiac shed. Number 5 is the esophagus. And the esophagus is a soft tissue, so it cannot be seen unless a barium meal of barium sulfate is taken by the patient to stain the lining of the esophagus. To stain the lining of the esophagus. If it is not stained by a barium meal, the esophagus cannot be seen. Number 5 is the esophagus in the posterior mediastinum or in the retrocardiac space. Number 3 is the diaphragm.